second game in this doubleheader. For those of you who weren't here at 4 o'clock, we spent a little over an hour with Adam Siminski, the administrator of the Energy Information Administration, discussing their new research into well productivity and decline rates to give us a sense of some of the new data the EI has on the magnitude of the U.S. Tight oil and shale gas boom and how much of this resource there really might be in the United States. And so we're really happy to follow that up with a broader look at what's happening in the North American natural gas outlook and how that outlook has completely flipped on its head and changed in remarkable ways in a really short period of time. And really could not have someone better to help us understand that than Paul Joskow. His bio is on a piece of paper that everyone has, so I won't go through it all, but Paul is the president of the Alfred P. Sloan Foundation, and before that was on the faculty at MIT, and is one of the leading energy economists in the country for decades. And really, when you're talking about how the energy world is changing, what the economic implications of it are, what the environmental and geopolitical implications of it are, you really can't think of someone better to help us understand that than Paul. So the title of his talk is From Shortages to Abundance, Natural Gas, Past, Present, and Future. And one of the questions I had is how an economist thinks about the word shortage and exactly what the shortage was. We tend to think of that as like gas station lines, but as opposed to prices. So we'll be really interested to hear his view on how the natural gas outlook has changed and where we're headed from here. So please join me in welcoming Paul Joskow.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here. Does anyone mind if I take my jacket off? Thank you, Jason. I can see Jason's not old enough to remember natural gas shortages. The origin of the title of this talk will become clearer as I go through it, but it really should have been called From Shortages to Abundance, Scarcity to abundance again. The natural gas market is pretty amazing. So I'm going to talk about natural gas. Natural gas is an energy source. It's primarily methane, CH4, for those of you who have a little chemistry. And in gaseous form, when you light a match or a spark, it reacts with oxygen and produces CO2, H2O, water, and a lot of energy. And it's a primary source of energy in most sectors of the U.S. economy, the residential sector, the commercial sector, the industrial sector, the utility sector. The one exception is the transportation sector, where very little natural gas is used. Now let's see if I can figure out how to use this. Okay. So just to remind people, because I'll be coming back to this, let me say something about energy policy goals. People say the U.S. doesn't have an energy policy. I don't know if that's true or not. Maybe it's a good thing we don't have an energy policy. But if we had an energy policy, it would stand primarily on three legs with some context in the background. We'd like to produce and price and use energy as efficiently as possible to support economic growth and development. And I view that both statically in the short run, but also in the long run in terms of encouraging technological innovation. And one of the interesting parts of the story about shale gas that I'll cover is the interaction of several different technological advances. At least since the early 1970s, we've sought to promote energy and economic security by reducing the probability and impacts of global energy supply disruptions. I think there's a lot of confusion about energy security, and that's a talk for another lecture. And we'd like a third stool to be important as well, for the first two to be consistent with environmental and safety standards and goals. And in many cases, these three legs on the stool are partially in conflict with one another. I think natural gas is going to turn out to be a case where the conflicts are much less significant than for other energy resources, especially coal and oil. So just to to get started, natural gas comes from a number of different types of deposits in the U.S. and in other countries. Conventional natural gas deposits, those that began to be exploited in the 1920s and the 1930s, are relatively shallow. They're in fairly porous rocks, relatively close to the surface. They come in two types of pools, what are called non-associated gas pools. Those are just gas primarily and some natural gas liquids, like ethane. But then they also come in so-called associated gas pockets, that is where they're intermingled with oil as well. Much shallower, there's shallow gas deposits. And the shallow gas deposits are in coal beds. They're sometimes old lake bottoms in fairly shallow shales, and there are organic compounds that are being turned into methane. I'll discuss later. I know most of you probably seen Gaslands, the movie about has the water and the gas intermingled and blowing. Most of the gas that becomes associated with drinking water is from very, very shallow gas deposits, typically a result of someone drilling a well into an area that has organic material, primarily coal, and gas is released into the well water. For reasons I'll discuss in more detail, relatively little, if any, gas from shale deposits appears in drinking water. There are worse things that can appear in the drinking water, and in fact, the focus on methane is probably unfortunate because there are other environmental issues that are more important. Methane in water, I'll come back to this. There, it's been documented back to about 1904. Long before the final source of natural gas that I'll talk about, or sources were conceived of as being possible. So the current primary sources of natural gas in the U.S. are very deep shale deposits. This is rock with very low porosity. Everyone's known there were pockets of natural gas in it, tiny little bubbles of natural gas for many, many years, but it was thought that it would be impossible to produce it. And then there also are somewhat more porous deposits, so-called tight sands, that are also relatively deep. And I'm going to focus today primarily on shale gas for a number of reasons, having to do with its importance to the economy, but also the role of technology and the role of surprises as they've affected the energy sector. And that's the importance of being prepared for surprises in forming energy policy is really very important. Okay, when I started at MIT, which was in 1972, in the economics department, the people working on energy were all working on natural gas shortages. So that's where the beginning of this title comes from. And this is the front page of a paper by two of my then colleagues, Paul McAvoy and Bob Pindyke, who were exploring using econometric models and similar techniques, the magnitude of the natural gas shortage, and the potential effect of different policies in alleviating it. So what do we mean by a shortage? Here we come and answer the question. Beginning in 1954, the federal government began to regulate the ceiling price of natural gas produced for sale in interstate commerce in the United States. I won't go into the history of how it came to be regulated, but there's still a debate about that. It was a Supreme Court decision called the Phillips decision. It came after World War II as natural gas demand began to explode, especially in the Midwest and the Northeast. Prices began to rise, and the courts determined that the Natural Gas Act, which was passed in 1935, in fact required the then Federal Power Commission, now the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, to regulate the price of natural gas sold in the field as if it, the same way it regulated the prices for pipeline service and as states would regulate the prices for electricity distribution service and local gas and water services. The problem is, and I won't go through all the history, is it was really hard to regulate the price of natural gas using traditional regulatory principles, that is, cost of service. Resources have upward sloping supply curves, as depicted here. Trying to figure out what the cost is at the price that would clear the market is very, very difficult. There were thousands and thousands of natural gas producers at that time spread all over the United States with very different costs. They competed. If the price was too low, they didn't produce. And because of the difficulties of trying to regulate an industry with thousands of producers with no obligation to serve, using well-by-well and then field-by-field cost of service techniques, prices fell way behind the level that would have led to supply and demand to clear, and we had shortages and allocation rules. So the allocation rules, there were about 11 different allocation rules. When there was an inadequate supply, the first off were industrial customers and utility customers. Then came off commercial customers. Then at the very last would come off residential customers. And the local utilities were not permitted to sign up new customers, sort of an invisible kind of shortage that resulted from the fact that there was not going to be sufficient supply going forward. And people have estimated the costs of this, very, very costly. And the numbers, if you projected out into the future, were quite large. This is a graph from one of McAvoy and Pindyke's papers. And if you look at the third column from the right, you see their estimates of excess demand for production. That's a shortage. That means that's demand that would have been there, wanted to be there at the prevailing price, but couldn't be served because the price was too low. This was recognized as a problem before the first oil embargo in 1973 and 1975, with the first oil price shock, but it became much more of a problem after that. Just as a note of interest, a lot of people were interested in this subject. So Steve Breyer was then a young professor at Harvard Law School. He's now a Supreme Court justice. He wrote on this subject as well. In fact, a chapter in a book he wrote in 1980 is probably the best description of the causes of natural gas shortages that one can find. And I don't think many people know that Ben Bernanke, who was still too young to be a professor, wrote his undergraduate thesis on natural gas price deregulation. So it's a subject that interested a lot of people. And we can think of sort of a variety of eras, and I want to talk mostly about the recent era, but I think it's interesting. This is a time series of natural gas wellhead prices. These are the prices charged where the natural gas is produced in the field. And the period up till 1980 was a period of shortages caused by price controls that kept natural gas from rising to competitive market levels. In 1979, the Natural Gas Policy Act was passed by President Carter, finally recognized that the reason for the shortages was that prices were too low and that a mechanism had to be found to provide incentives for new producers to enter the market and to produce natural gas, and for higher cost producers to come into the market so that it would clear. Unfortunately, very soon after this act was passed, there were two more shocks in quick succession, the war between Iran and Iraq, and the overthrow of the Shah in Iran, and that led to more supply disruptions and to a very, very significant increase in the price of oil. The way natural gas was the process for deregulating it was, they defined two different kinds of gas. There was sort of old gas, that was gas we found in the past, and new gas, that was gas found in the future and produced. And the idea was that you could pay a lot for new gas and average it in with the price of old gas, and the result of this would be that the average price would gradually move up and clear the market. And as the old gas was depleted, new gas would dominate the market and prices would approach market levels. Unfortunately, when oil prices rose dramatically after 1980, Despite the passage of that law, shortages got even worse. And shortages got worse because high oil prices led a lot of users of oil and boilers and utilities to try to switch to natural gas. There just wasn't enough natural gas, and prices weren't rising fast enough to clear the market. New gas prices began to rise very, very quickly. Perhaps the greatest beneficiaries of this in the early 1980s were the Canadians, whose gas prices weren't regulated. They sold at very high prices. And just as prices were beginning to rise fairly quickly, the price of oil collapsed in the early 1980s. But gas prices kept rising. And the result of this was that now there was a surplus of natural gas. Nobody wanted all the gas the pipelines were selling at the now regulated price that was too high, and began to seek methods for bypassing the pipelines. And this continued, this tug of war between consumers and producers, until the late 1980s, when the natural gas industry was restructured. Natural gas wellhead prices were fully deregulated. They were separated from pipeline charges, were fully separated from natural gas production and distribution. And then a lot of this gas that had been discovered at very high prices began to be made available to the market at very low prices. And during the 1990s, people thought we had a surplus of natural gas, that there was an abundant supply, it would last forever. They built new gas-fired power plants. People switched from electric heat to gas heat. As you can see, during the 1990s, gas prices are relatively low and not very volatile, although more volatile than during the regulated period. And then when everyone thought that natural gas had found the solution, they discovered in 2001 that suddenly natural gas wasn't as abundant as they thought, and natural gas prices began to rise rather dramatically. And you see that beginning in around 2000, culminating in 2008 or so, in extremely high natural gas prices. So now everyone decided, well, we've got to get off of natural gas. It's too expensive. We're going to have to import it in the form of LNG from other countries. We'll look at this. And just as the first import terminals were being ready to import natural gas, the price of natural gas dropped. And it dropped because of the unanticipated supplies of natural gas from the shale deposits, the deep shale deposits that I previously discussed. So this is a sector that has had continuing surprises going forward. And it's just that was the price side. There's the quantity side. You see quantities going up fairly significantly until the early 1970s, then going down during this period of shortages when prices were kept too low. Then prices finally got up to a higher level in the early 80s, and then oil prices collapsed and natural gas prices eventually collapsed as well, and the industry began to be restructured. So let's bring ourselves to the early 2000s, to 2001 and 2002. By this time, people had gotten into their heads that natural gas was now a premium fuel. The U.S. was not going to be able to meet demand. There are forecasts all over the place as to how supply and demand would be balanced with some combination of imports of liquefied natural gas, a gas pipeline from northern Alaska that would bring gas down to the U.S. through Canada, and the Mackenzie Delta is similarly an Arctic production area that is east of the Alaskan production areas, but in Canada. LNG was going to be the fuel imported from places like Indonesia and Algeria and Qatar and others to help clear the market. That was the National Petroleum Council. You figure, well, they're looking after themselves. The Energy Information Administration, where the previous speaker is employed today, they made similar forecasts. They had LNG imports. This is as recently as 2004, and I can tell you this went on until 2007 or 2008. Liquefied natural gas and Alaskan gas at very high prices would come into the market. Gas shales were viewed as being a tiny potential source of natural gas, as long as prices were high. And That was the general view. People applied to build LNG import terminals to bring in all that gas to the U.S. Here's a list of those that had announced proposals by 2003. And that was sort of the future picture. People planning manufacturing plants, people planning electric power facilities did not view natural gas anymore as being a fuel of choice because the view was it was going to be too expensive. So let's get back to what happened. Again, a lot of surprises going along here. So let's go down to the shales. The shales are 6 to 10,000 feet below the surface. They're very, I actually have a piece of shale. I didn't bring it with me. They're very porous rocks, non-porous rocks. People knew it was there, but everyone thought it was uneconomical because to drill a vertical well into an area where there wasn't really much gas in a local area was just uneconomical. You didn't get much gas out for drilling an 8,000-foot well. So technological innovation and the interaction of technologies was very, very important here, and I think there are really some lessons here. So what are the technologies that were important? The first was horizontal drilling. That's the horizontal portion of the well. The technology made it possible to basically turn the drill bit horizontally to move along the shale deposit and to extract natural gas along the deposit. That was the first innovation. The second innovation has to do with telemetry and data analysis, which made it possible to keep track of exactly where the drill bit was in this long horizontal area and to analyze what the concentration was of natural gas or oil. There also is oil found in some of these deposits we have now discovered. And the third innovation was hydraulic fracking. Now, hydraulic fracturing was not a new technology. It had been used in enhanced oil recovery since the late 1940s. It involves, I'll discuss this a little bit more in a while, basically using high-pressure water combined with sand and some chemicals to open up the non-porous rocks to allow the gas to come into it. And there's a lot of talk about fracking now, and I'll talk more about it, but fracking itself is not new. They used it in vertical wells for many, many years. It's the interaction of these three technological innovations that were really fundamental in making this an economical source of energy. Another factor that's important is that this was developed not by ExxonMobil or by Chevron or by Total. It was developed by small producers, and particularly a man named George Mitchell, who passed away this year in Texas, who in the mid-1990s, with funding from the Gas Research Institute, some private funding, some DOE funding, Department of Energy funding, was convinced that you could make this work. And his oil company, Mitchell Oil, was the first company to develop gas shale gas operations in near Fort Worth in Texas. And many of the earliest developers of this technology were new entrants. They were independents who had confidence that this technology would could be used to extract what had been thought of as being an unavailable resource. In fact, the large oil companies had basically abandoned onshore development. And there's something to say for small business here, I think, in terms of innovation and risk-taking that is sometimes ignored. Of course, the big companies have now come back in. They bought up the little companies. Mr. Mitchell sold his company. I think Devon owns it now. I think he probably made a lot of money, which is a nice thing. But the technology was really deployed and demonstrated by small companies. So what are we talking about here? This is just a graph that focuses on the vertical and horizontal portions of the well. So there's a vertical portion that comes down into the shale deposit, which could be as high as this room or two or three stories. The drill bit is turned. It's drilled along a horizontal area out to several miles, possibly. Then there are explosives put into it to put holes in the well. Then high pressure hydraulic fracturing fluid, mostly water, sand, and some chemicals is pumped into it to open up the pores. You can see that in the box here, to open up the pores in the shale deposit to allow the gas to flow out of the well. Hydraulic fracturing, it uses a lot of water. We'll come back to that. It takes about 3 weeks to complete a well like the one depicted here. Typically today, from a particular well pad, they will do 5 to 10 horizontal wells in different directions to conserve on that infrastructure. Once the well is drilled, it's capped, the trucks that move fluid and sands in and out, and the electric generators and the storage facilities, they go away to the next site. When I talk about some of the environmental impacts, we'll come back to that. But that's the basic story, and the technology keeps improving. That's the other thing that I think is important. And I don't know what the speaker said before, but the supply estimates just keep growing as people learn more about this technology. So I just want to focus, I'll come back to this, at the very top of the well is the wellhead. That's where the water aquifer is. That's where one area of concern for release of methane, to a lesser extent, but the release of fracking fluids. Because fracking fluids have got crap in them. That's a scientific term. They've got chemicals in them that are used as lubricants and for other reasons, but they also bring up out of the shale deposit all kinds of other stuff as the well is being completed. And you can see that there a special attention is supposed to be paid to lining and cementing containing the top of the well, supposed to be done. And a properly executed well has gone through redundant methods for securing the portion of the well directly below and directly above the water aquifer. That's what it would look like if this was going on your farm in Pennsylvania. That's a well that's in the process of being drilled. Once it's finished, it doesn't look like that. There's just a wellhead there. But while it's being drilled, there are generators on the site. There are trucks coming in and out. Pipelines have to be built to gather the gas and to transport it to the main line. So this is an industrial process. Don't let anyone fool you about that. It's not something you would welcome easily in your backyard, for at least for a long period of time, unless you were getting oil and gas royalties, in which case you might. Be happy to tolerate it for some period of time. The actual footprint is not that big. It's about an acre for a pad like this, but an area may have many, many pads. If you've flown over Fort Worth, you can see them. Your first reaction is that, boy, they have a lot of sand traps and all the golf courses around here. And then you look carefully, and they're not golf courses, they're not sand traps. They're pads like this. So shale is everywhere in the U.S. It's in Canada, it's in Alberta, it's in northeastern British Columbia, it's in the northeastern U.S., it's in the West, it's in Texas, it's all over the place. And some of these shale deposits are primarily gas, and some of them, in particular the Bakken, which is in North Dakota and goes up into Canada, is mostly oil and some gas. And I think the economics of this is sort of interesting because the relative price of oil and gas is playing a very significant role in what people look for and how much gas is being produced. And gas is oil is very expensive now, and gas is very cheap. The relative prices are at historic highs, and a lot of the activity in the U.S. is being driven by the high price of oil, and producers are looking for wet air, so-called wet shale gas deposits, that is deposits where they're going to find a lot of oil and not so much natural gas. Okay, so you saw those previous graphs. Now let's go to the future. Until around 2008 and 2009, nobody talked much about shale gas, except in theory. This was now an almost year-old forecast from the Energy Information Administration of current shale gas production and projected future shale gas production. And today, here's a more contemporary picture of actual production. If you probably don't think in billions of cubic feet or trillions of cubic feet or other units or BTUs, but just to give you a sense, today shale gas accounts for almost 40% of the natural gas produced in the U.S. And this is just a stunning reverse in expectations in a very, very short period of time. And what's also stunning is it's continued even though the price of natural gas has stayed at very low levels, in part because of new techniques for extracting more gas from wells, and in part because of the high price of oil that's continued to make it interesting to drill, especially in areas where there's oil. And all the here you see all the recent, this is the, is something called the Potential Gas Committee. I'm sure an exciting committee to sit on, probably as good as a tenure committee. Yeah, for years they projected every year what the resources were, and they were kind of flat. And then suddenly starting in 2006, and more importantly in 2008, shale gas becomes very important. They discover it and they begin to include it in their reserve estimates. And we see it in relative production, quads or quadrillion BTUs. Natural gas production is now rising relatively rapidly. Coal production has been falling. Oil production in the U.S. is rising for the first time in, since roughly 1980. We're seeing a real change in the resource mix, the domestic resource mix. And whereas in the previous slides I showed you, we saw consumption growing faster than production and imports growing. In fact, now we expect that imports not only are declining, but will continue to decline to the point where the U.S. will become a natural gas exporter. So these are imports of petroleum and natural gas, which are both declining, not entirely in the case of petroleum as a result of shale gas, but also the economy's been kind of bad. We have new efficiency standards for cars and trucks. For reasons people don't understand, people aren't driving more miles each year as they did for decades before. But imports are declining fairly quickly. At the same time, prices beyond 2010 have stayed low as these gas supplies have become available. And this has implications, which I'll come back to in the environment, is one of the places where gas and other and coal are good substitutes is in the electric power sector. And what you see is as gas prices fell, especially in 2012, utilities switched from coal to natural gas. And this has attractive environmental properties. It means less CO2 produced. A gas-fired plant produces about half the CO2 of a coal-fired plant. It also has other attractive environmental benefits. When you burn natural gas, you don't produce mercury, you don't produce sulfur dioxide, you don't produce particulates, you don't produce a lot of conventional pollutants. So this substitution is very, very attractive, and it's one of the things that got a number of environmental groups extremely excited about the opportunity to substitute economically natural gas for coal to get some short and medium-term reductions in U.S. CO2 emissions. And this was always viewed as a very attractive feature of this newfound resource that nobody anticipated, as giving some bang to our non-existent policies to promote natural gas use. I should note the Obama administration's one of their primary policies for reducing CO2 emissions is to give some more juice to the substitution by making it more and more difficult for coal plants to operate, with the idea that gas would be the substitute and the economic penalty would be very small. That's with everything else. That's now in court. But the EPA quite clearly is pursuing that as a policy. Natural gas is projected to continue to increase in supplies in the U.S. Becomes by far the largest source of domestic fossil fuels, according to these EIA projections, And this takes place even though natural gas prices stay at relatively low levels compared to the very high prices that emerged in the first decade of this century. And remember those natural gas terminals? Are we going to import all this natural gas? Well, forget about it. Now we're going to export natural gas. And depending on what forecast you look at, whether you consider North America as a whole, which I think is the right way of thinking about it, or just the United States in isolation, we're going to be going from net imports, primarily from Canada now, to being a net exporter to the rest of the world. And that means we will still import gas from Canada because we have pipelines and it's kind of close. So this is sort of an underestimate. It'll probably be closer to 10% of our production will be actually exported outside of North America later in this century. And the oil supply picture, for the reasons I discussed, is also attractive. Our imports had risen in the early 2000s to about 60% of our consumption. They're now declining. We will not be an oil exporter. We may export some products and import crude oil, but overall, the supply situation is much improved. Getting back to CO2, this is another EIA. I don't want to be critical of the Energy Information Administration. They do the best they can. But this was the companion forecast in 2004 of what CO2 emissions would be in 2025, and they'd rise from about 5 billion metric tons per year to about 8 billion metric tons per year, and that's sort of the opposite of what most climate change policies are trying to accomplish. And if you look at their latest 2012 forecast, by 2025 and 2035, basically total energy-related carbon dioxide emissions are projected over the next 20 or 25 years to basically be constant. In 2012, U.S. CO2 emissions were at their lowest level since 1995. And that's a real turnaround. And while it doesn't give you the large reduction that would be necessary to really fundamentally deal with climate change, it's a whole lot better place to start at 5 or 6,000 metric tons and million metric tons in 2035 than at 8 or 9 million metric tons. And a lot of this is due to cheap natural gas. It's also due to other policies as well. And every year, I always love these curves where I get to go back and compare forecasts. These are the forecasts of energy-related carbon dioxide emissions coming from the Energy Information Administration every year. And you can see they keep falling. And the three primary reasons that they're falling are natural gas, reduced consumption by the transportation sector of petroleum, and increased renewable energy, although it grows quickly, but is still relatively small, and reduced economic growth. And those are the four things that explain this, but cheap natural gas is certainly part of it. So that's North America. The good news, even better news from an energy security perspective, is there's shale all over the world. While this technology was developed in North America, it is potentially deployable elsewhere around the world, in Latin America, in North Africa, in China, in Russia, and in Europe, and substantial potential in Australia. And from an energy global energy security perspective, this is potentially very exciting because it will not only increase global supplies of natural gas, but almost certainly increase global supplies of oil as well, and from a much more diversified set of production regions than we now rely on heavily in the Middle East, in North Africa, and in Western Africa. So going back to the original context, from a economic perspective, this is, sometimes they say that Moses had to spend 40 years in the desert because he had to find the one place in the Middle East where there was no oil or gas. Well, they actually found gas off of Israel also, but this is the manna from heaven from an economic perspective. It looks very good from a energy security perspective. The U.S. becomes an exporter rather than an importer Our imports of petroleum shrink well below what was expected. And if developments happen elsewhere in the world, the increased supplies will not only mean lower prices for us, but lower prices everywhere and a much diversified supply portfolio. And from an environmental perspective, if you focus only on CO2 emissions, it's a good deal as well. However, let's come back to our shale well. There are lots of people who worry about the impacts of shale production on the environment, on different aspects of the environment. So we'll start at the top. When you drill a well, there are trucks coming in and out. There are diesel generators there. There are storage facilities for sand and for water and for chemicals. From a local perspective, this is a fairly disruptive activity. It may not last all that long, but it's disruptive. Second, it uses a lot of water. There's, at least for a short period of time, there are some areas that have lots of water, but other areas where water is much scarcer, so there are concerns about depleting the oil resource. We've already discussed concerns about contaminating water, drinking water. There are two ways that can happen. There can be a defect in the casing at the top of the well. I would argue the methane is of less concern than the toxic chemicals coming into the water if you should have that. Methane is not really very toxic. It also evaporates when it comes in contact with air, so there's the only real danger is you'll get burned. Of more concern is what happens when you bring the stuff to the top. And if it's not stored properly and disposed of properly, the fracking fluid, the residue from the well, you can contaminate, especially above ground drinking water and perhaps water aquifers, with toxic chemicals. And that is an issue of some reasonable concern. And there have been a number of papers that have found some evidence of contamination associated with some wells. We won't go through that. So there's a case for environmental regulation here, establishing standards and monitoring and inspections for drilling, for disposal of wastes, and for establishing local regulations regarding truck traffic and the use of diesel generators and other activities. And if you look at, and this is from a Resources for the Future, one of the places we've given grants to study this, I would say that regulation in this area is not well developed. I've just picked the most obvious one, casing and cementing, because it's the concern people have about leakage directly from the well. But the same story is true in other areas. A lot of this is regulated by the states. And just looking at the graph, there are some states that have a history of regulation and tight standards. The standards vary from state to state. There are other states that don't have well-developed standards. There are no standards for federal lands yet. I mean, this is a new concept. So I think there's a good case that we need to develop best practices, and they need to be deployed across the states. This is just another how they test the cement, which is really very, very important. And again, there's a wide variation in the regulations across states. So there's clearly room for government regulation here in the environmental side, but I think it's doable. It's not brain science. It's politics of getting the regulations in place, getting the resources to monitor the well drilling and to penalize those who don't abide by the regulations. This is just another picture. This is fracking fluid that's being stored above ground. Well, it doesn't look so pretty, number one. Number two, if you look far in the background, there's a lake. You really don't want it leaking into the lake. You don't want it leaking into the groundwater. If there's a bad storm, you don't want it overflowing into the area. It's not real pretty. And this is a site that does not have the latest storage and is not heavily regulated, and that's something that, again, RFF is developing best practices to try to deploy them across the states. This is the construction of a pipeline. The gas to get from where it's produced to where it can be used, you've got to build pipelines. This is a pipeline under construction. Now, you have to imagine, once it's finished, the pipeline's underground, the bulldozers go away, the people go away. All that's left is a right-of-way without trees on it. But nevertheless, during the period of time when it's being built, it's rather disruptive. We do have well-developed pipeline regulations, so I don't see that as a significant problem in terms of permitting and construction from a safety perspective, at least. But again, if you live near one of these, it's not something that you're going to like very much. Well, so it looked like economically very good, environmentally CO2 very good, other environmental issues addressable. Energy security, a big plus. This is one of those really happy energy stories. Except methane, which is primarily what natural gas is a greenhouse gas. In fact, it's a very potent greenhouse gas. Depending on the time frame you look at, 10 years to 100 years, it's 25 to 100 times more potent than CO2. So one says, wait a minute, maybe natural gas isn't so good if it leaks out into the atmosphere, because it will displace CO2 with CH4. They're both greenhouse gases. One is more potent. There must be some break-even point where, if there are leaks of natural gas, there will be a serious negative environmental consequence from a climate change perspective. Now, I'm a little cynical about the interest in this because there are also people building windmills and solar energy don't like cheap electricity. But people have raised, I think, a legitimate issue. Most of the pipelines and distribution systems in the U.S. have been built according to safety criteria. So Con Ed, monitors its system. If you smell gas, you call Con Ed, and they'll come and they'll fix it. Or if it's in your house, they'll tell you to leave, and they'll come and fix it. And if you're leaking natural gas from a pipeline, it costs you money. So one would think that there were, between regulatory schemes and natural incentives, that leakage wouldn't be a problem. However, here's a picture of gas leaks. So this is in the Fort Worth area. And it appears that there's significantly more leakage of gas in some areas, and in particular at some wellheads, than people had thought. The EPA does have numbers for this. Natural gas from the energy sector, they're actually pretty small. This is a big issue that's has come up. The Sloan Foundation recently funded a big study that's being sponsored by the Environmental Defense Fund, but it involves multiple universities and a large number of companies to identify gas leaks, where they're likely to occur, to identify new technologies for identifying gas leaks, and to develop regulations that will plug up the gas leaks for environmental reasons, not just for safety reasons. I think this is, from a climate change perspective, if you want to view this as a good thing, that the whole issue of methane leaks is going to have to be resolved. My personal view is, if you had to ask me, what are we going to discover? I think we're going to discover this is much ado about very little. On the other hand, even if they can develop new detection technologies and they can find sources where they're not being very careful about capturing methane at the wellhead or in the gathering system, where I think the biggest problems are likely to lie, I think it'll be a very good thing. And if you talk to the people who run the gas system in Boston or New York, as I have, they're cooperating in this. They really don't want to lose gas either. If you ask them, well, why didn't you know this before, you discover their regulatory regime has a factor called unaccounted for gas, which they get paid for, and they may not have had the strongest incentives other than the safety regulations for looking for these areas of leakage. So this is now one of the other environmental issues on the frontier from a climate change perspective. Is it really a net benefit if we take methane leakage into account? If methane leakage really is a problem, how can we reduce it significantly to make it a net benefit? And I'm finished and ready for questions.
Thanks very much, Paul. That was a really fascinating overview and a lot of great information. So I'm going to ask Professor Pinho to just moderate a conversation with Paul. And I want to thank Manuel Pinho for sponsoring the Leaders in Energy series that this is a part of, and just turn it over to you. Thanks.
Professor Joskow, thank you very much for a brilliant presentation. Would you mind, would you like to raise some issues? Please.
And sorry, just to clarify, we could have folks just line up along the edge and speak from the microphone. Then the people watching online will be able to hear the questions as well. Thank you.
Just for in thank 5 you. Years.
How will thank, you thank you for your very interesting question. my question to you is, my name is Jim Dingman. I'm from Pacifica Radio. I wanted you to go further into the issue of the environmental problems, particularly with water. You know, in all throughout the country, there's a tremendous opposition to this. Anti-fracking campaigns are going on all over the country. And in some cases, it has to do with what they perceive as the effect on the water table. Now, one has a history with the energy industry going back decades of not necessarily believing what they say for good reason. So I wanted to ask you what your opinion of that particular critique is, the one on the water table, and also the issue of formulas about how to actually bring it up. Because I understand, and correct me if I'm wrong, that in Alaska, the actual chemical formula for fracking is not being allowed to be seen by the state. And I'd like to know if that's true or not, and if that's true, how, well, pervasive is it? Because it does indeed affect how people understand the impact.
Okay, so let me talk about drinking water. Because that's, I think I talked about that, but let me say a few things. Methane leakage is something we've lived with since the early 1900s, at least it's documented. Most of the methane leakage comes from shallow wells that are drilled by residences. It's not toxic. It's not in general associated with hydraulic fracturing. It could be if you had a bad well, but if you have a bad well that cracks in the aquifer, as I said, I think there are worse things that happen than some methane leakage. I think the mix of fracking fluids, and it's not only the fracking fluids, but when they drill the well, of course they bring that stuff. You've drilled a hole, and it comes up from deep underground, and it's got toxic chemicals in it as well. I consider the storage and disposal of the wastewater, and including disposing of the chemicals in the water properly, to be a significant environmental challenge. Again, it's a solvable challenge, but I put it on the table as much more important than turning on your faucet and having some natural gas come out of it. How good are we at doing this? Well, as I said, the regulations are really, in general, not as well developed as they should be. And the states where shale gas production is taking place are, by and large, rapidly trying to enhance their regulations. Colorado's doing a really good job. Ohio's doing a really good job. Very few states have actually stopped shale gas development. New York has stopped it. California has stopped it. There is controversy around it, of course, but I think some of it's not as well informed as it could be. But again, I think those problems are solvable once they're identified. And again, I think the focus on the methane in the water was not as important as the disposal of the chemicals and residue from the fracking wells and how they're recycled and where they're ultimately stored. So it's an issue that I think has to be addressed from a regulatory perspective. I should note it's not that much different from oil and gas drilling regularly. This is, if you've ever been in an oil field, it's not someplace it's not that nice. It stinks. It's filthy. It's got gathering stuff running all over the place. There's drilling mud that has to be disposed of. So, in that regard, I think it's part of a problem with potential environmental problem with oil and gas drilling generally. I think one of the things that's changed is you saw my picture of all the places where the shale gas deposits lie. A lot of these are areas that don't have a history of oil and gas exploration and development. New York is a good example. Of course, Pennsylvania, they used to produce gas and oil, but they really haven't produced in significant quantities for a very long time. Ohio has not. So unlike Texas or Louisiana, where people become accustomed to drilling and development, I think people in these states are much more sensitive. And in a blue state like New York, which is more environmentally sensitive, you'd expect them to be more sensitive to these things. But I think that requires more effective regulation to be devoted to it.
I should have said, if folks could just briefly identify themselves and keep your questions brief, and then we'll move through the line. We have about 25 minutes for questions. Thanks.
Good evening. Lucas Finko, Consolidated Edison. Thanks for coming here tonight. New York State has been moving away from coal generation and also significantly away from nuclear generation, and most of it has been replaced with natural gas generation, electricity generation. And I'm wondering, when would you suggest to the regulators that they need to step in and try and steer us away from a single source for fuel for electricity generation?
Well, of course, as you know, since you're from the utility industry, New York has a competitive market for generation and for new generating capacity. It also has a very robust program for subsidizing renewables for wind and solar energy. This is always in the back of my mind a concern. If you look at the economics, from an economic and environmental perspective, most of the coal's gone already. Maybe there's some left upstate. The nuclear power plants are going to close sooner or later, probably sooner than most people may think, but with low power prices. And you don't really have that many choices. You've got gas, you've got renewables, wind and solar primarily. You've got energy efficiency investments. And I think that's what the future is going to look like. Now, what in the back of my mind troubles me about that, if we become very dependent on natural gas, as we already are here and in New England, well, it's the surprises. Go through the whole history from, just after I was born till today. Everyone agrees there's abundant supply and prices will be low. And then it turns out there's less supply than we thought and prices are high. And then it turns out that was wrong too. So, that's something that does concern me a little bit, but not enough to suggest that we build more coal plants in New York for environmental reasons. It may have some implications for the existing nuclear plants if one would want to debate because they're carbon free. On the other hand, you don't own Indian Point anymore, I don't think. Indian Point is probably the worst site in the world for a nuclear power plant from a safety perspective. So I think that's sort of worth discussing. There will be natural gas in our future one way or the other because renewables are intermittent sources of electricity. If the wind blows, that's fine. If the sun shines, that's fine. But if it's a still cloudy day, you need backup power, and it's going to be gas. It'll be with us for quite a while, and we'll have to depend on it. And I think the best way of keeping prices from spiking again is in an environmentally responsible way to continue to develop these supply sources both in the U.S. and in other countries.
Hello. Ed Crooks from the Financial Times. I just wanted to pick up on your point there about surprises. I was very interested to hear your discussion of the last age of abundant gas back in the 1990s. And I wonder if you could just explain a little bit more about why we thought gas was abundant then and why we turned out to be wrong about it. And also then just what you think the chances are that in 15 years' time, we'll be looking back on the early years of this decade and thinking we thought we had gas for 100 years, how wrong we were.
Okay. Looking back on the 1990s, I think there are a number of factors, and 2020 hindsight's worth a lot, so I'm going to use 2020 hindsight. Deregulation and coming off of the wacky regulations that especially we had during the 1980s stable oil prices. Basically, if you look at 1990, there was just a lot of supply that had been there, but was now available at relatively low prices. So that you saw the prices were relatively stable. Gas supplies didn't increase that much, but at the same time, the U.S. lost a lot of manufacturing production during the 1980s, which had used natural gas as a boiler fuel. Environmental regulations made it less attractive to use oil and coal, and gas gradually pushed out other fossil fuels in as a boiler fuel and a new electric generating capacity. And, you know, actually, to EIA's credit, they were doing forecasts in the 1990s that said prices were going to go up a lot. I'm not sure they had it quite exactly how much they went up, but they went up. They didn't see a tremendous supply. They thought it was sort of a short-term supply bubble in a sense. And I don't know. People believed it, and the price spikes that started in 2001. Which are one of the primary causes of the California electricity crisis, by the way, were a big surprise to lots of people. And there was one month in, I don't know if it was 2006 or 2007, when prices went as high as $15 a MCF at Henry Hub in Louisiana. They're now about $3.60. And that was, no one wanted to pay that much for it. And that also led to all the applications for import terminals and debates about building another pipeline to northern Alaska to carry natural gas and to the Mackenzie Delta in Canada and so on and so on. So one has to have, I think when one makes forecasts, it's really not a great idea to just look at the last 3 years and this year. I think you really need some really good models that understand the resource base. On the other hand, I don't think you could have predicted this technological development that made shale gas and shale oil so economical. Nobody saw it except for George Mitchell and a few other people in the late 1990s, and no one believed it until as recently as 2007 and 2008. So there are surprises, you know, exactly how we prepare for them, I'm not sure, although diversification, if you can do it, is always a good first bet.
Michael Bloom, formerly of the United Nations Energy Office. I want to turn to something else that relies on new technology, one not yet developed, and that is or the source of natural gas not in your graphic, and that is hydrates. I wonder what you see in the future for hydrates as a supply.
For what as a surprise?
Natural gas hydrates.
Oh, hydrates. I haven't studied natural gas hydrates. Can I call them frozen natural gas to make it simple? Hydrates scare me more than I think of it as a commercial source of natural gas. Hydrates are in the ocean. They're under the tundra. They're frozen natural gas. If they were to be released again, it's a greenhouse gas. It would be very problematic. I don't know of a good technology for using them commercially or for harvesting them. If one could develop one, it would be another potential source. But I view it, hydrates more as an environmental problem than a solution.
Yes, my name is Max Pejor. I'm a contributor with RBN Energy. You gave thank you very much for your presentation. You gave a nice technological overview of the development of hydrofracking.
Question is, you didn't discuss regulation. You discussed regulation at the state level, but not at the federal level. And I was curious to know to what degree the 2005 Energy Act, the indemnification provision of that, had to do with the rapid development of hydrofracking. You also referenced the gas and the two documentaries. Towards the end of the first documentary, there's a discussion of a potential bill by Maurice Hinchey and the congressperson from Colorado, a four-page bill removing the indemnification provision in the 2005 Energy Act. And I was one way of mitigating the problems that have arisen with development hydrofracking?
Well, I think from a regulatory an economic regulatory perspective, the most important effect was actually the deregulation of field prices and the restructuring of the natural gas industry. If this were 1970, you wouldn't have been able to do it. It would have taken forever to first of all, you had to convince a pipeline to bundle the gas together. You would have it would have been regulated based on some unknown cost of service formula. I think by 1990, that whole industry had been freed up. As I said, a lot of small companies had entered the market as producers when the large had exited the onshore U.S. as not being a productive future source for natural gas reserves. Obviously, I don't know how important the whatever indemnification provisions there are in terms of making these decisions. I suppose there are an extra cost, that's potential cost that's been eliminated. Quite frankly, for a lot of these companies that started, bankruptcy was probably the binding constraint and not the indemnification provisions. And this is always a problem with indemnification provisions. If you've got small, poorly capitalized companies, they go bust before they even really, even kick in. Very possibly. Very possibly. Oh, they get sued all the time. I mean, and there have been some big settlements because there certainly has been bad behavior. That's why you need a robust regulatory system. Again, my personal view is New York would have done better spending the last 2 years developing the best regulatory framework for permitting and for monitoring and for penalizing the violations than it has, sort of just talking about it. It just so happened, I get invited to these people against, they call it against fracking. They're against shale gas development in Larchmont. And there isn't any shale in Larchmont. There are a lot of rich people in Larchmont. Most of the shales along the southern tier of western New York State, where there are a lot of poor people. And if we can put a good regulatory framework in effect, they can decide as communities whether they want to bear the local burdens, the economic burdens and non-economic burdens of development. And overwhelmingly, they do want to bear, and they want the money. They're poor. And if we could assure them that we can deal with the disposal problems and the water problems and give them some flexibility in terms of local zoning laws and so on, I think for those people and for the country, it can be a win-win thing. Would I put these in the Catskill watershed? Would I let them? No. Would I let anyone put a big chemical plant in the Catskill? No. No matter how good the regulations are, there are going to be some accidents every now and then, and you don't want to put them in a place where there might actually be very, very significant damages that could occur.
So
yes.
That's the only source of water.
Yes, exactly.
Conscious of the people who are watching online, and the microphone stopped working, so if I can just ask folks to come up here and just pick this up for a second, and we'll use this microphone.
Hi,
you can lift it.
Oh, okay, all right, thanks. thanks again for that presentation. My name is Daniel Choi, and one question I had was, you talked about exporting natural gas, and when do you think that would happen, and then when that does happen, do you think there's going to be natural gas prices are going to bounce back to maybe $5-$6 per MMBTU? And then one more question was, are we producing shale gas offshore?
The first question is, I think there are three terminals now have permits, maybe it's four. And the first permits were given to some of those import
terminals because they had gas storage facilities and they have to put in liquefaction facilities now. There will clearly be an effect on domestic prices. They'll go up. I actually think the prices are way below their long-run equilibrium level now. It's probably more like $5 than it is $360 or $370. But I don't think the effect's going to be that big. And I think there will continue to be a very large basis difference, at least in the medium term, between the U.S., Asia, and Europe. And that's because it's expensive. You've got to liquefy the gas. That's expensive. You've got to put it in a tanker, frozen. That's expensive. You got to ship it across the Atlantic or probably the Pacific Ocean. That's pretty expensive. Then you have to have a import terminal where you take the gas off the tanker and regasify it, mix it with some other gas to make it compatible with your system, then export. So the estimates differ, but to Asia, the most frequent number is $6 to $8. I would say it could be higher on the margin, depending on exactly where the terminals are built and how they're financed and so on. So you're talking about, let's say, at least a $6 spread, basis spread, probably more between the United States and Asia. So it still is a substantial economic benefit to North America compared to the rest of the world. However, if the shale gas deposits elsewhere turn out to be as productive, and gas is developed in all of these areas, this then becomes a global market. It's not a global market now. It's a lot of isolated little markets, and the Russians and the Norwegians and the Algerians have their claws on the European market, so they price gas to equivalent to oil. So it's similarly in Asia. So it's $15 in Tokyo, while it's $3.50 here, and it's $11 in London when it's $3.50 here. But if they start producing gas in all these other areas where I showed you, it will be produced. It will eventually become a world market like anything else. And a lot of it won't be shipped. It'll be produced locally in those areas. And it will undermine the market power the Russians have and the Qataris have. And I think you could see much more, not equal, but much more equivalent prices across countries if it's developed. Now, as I'm sure you know, it's been a big issue in some areas, and we don't, unlike the U.S., that's been heavily drilled, we don't know that much about the shale deposits and what their productivity would be. I heard someone say it'll take the Europeans and Asians 20 years to understand the technology and deploy it, and we shouldn't worry about it. That sounded to me like someone from GM talking about Toyota in 1970. So I think a lot of this has to do with the how quickly governments in other countries want to try to exploit the resource. You know, France has a lot of shale. Unfortunately, it's under Paris. the Eiffel Tower might look like an outstanding drilling platform, but I can see that it would not be the kind of thing you'd want to pockmark Paris or the Île-de-France with these wells. In England, I don't want to comment on some of the rural areas in England, but the shale is sort of in the north, and it's in other places. But even if they don't develop it there, there's shale in Russia, there's shale in North Africa, there's a lot of shale in Latin America. So we'll have to see what policies those countries have, and whether they're willing to bring in companies that have the technological experience to deploy the technology quickly or not, because many of these countries. Have state-owned oil companies like Mexico, for example, which are not on the technological frontier. Let me just put it that way.
Hi, thanks very much for your talk. My name is Mika. I'm in the Environmental Science and Policy program here. And not to beat a dead horse, but I have another question about water. So in fracking, it's estimated that about 20 to 40% of the produced water is recaptured in those aquifers. And I'm wondering, you've talked a bit about regulation, but what's the likelihood or what are your thoughts on industry-driven innovation to capture more of that water and to deal with it?
Well, of course, the industry is very sensitive to this. I mean, I think they all know that tighter regulations are coming. I mean, they may fight them, but they all know they're coming. So they are experimenting with recycling technology is where you use the same water over and over again, with alternative disposal technologies, including reinjection deep into the earth, which has caused in some places earth tremors. There are also some experiments with not using water at all, with using natural gas. Basically, stuffing it with high-pressure natural gas and using that to blow up the shale deposit. And then the natural gas would then be withdrawn. You'd still have to dispose of the drilling waste. So I think there's a lot of efforts to, especially now by the larger companies which have moved into this area, to try to look for alternatives, because if the restrictions become very, very severe, they'll become very, very expensive, and I think we should expect them to respond. There are going to be tighter regulations on disposal, because I think scientifically the one thing that has been demonstrated is you find some of these deposits in drinking water, sometimes fairly remote from the sites, especially in surface drinking water, and some seeping back into the earth. There are other mundane. You have diesel fuel on these pads. That's not good for the water either. It's poison, and even down to that micro level, you've got to make sure that there are regulations to control those toxic substances. But soon the industry will not be using diesel generators, so just use natural gas for the generators too, is my guess.
My name is Raya Fasiri from the School of Electrical Engineering. First of all, thanks for such an interesting presentation. I have two questions. The first one, you discussed the issue of energy security worldwide. Clearly, now we have more accessible reserves of oil and gas than we ever did before. How does this affect the dependence on the Middle East as being the center of gravity of energy supply, and what implications could result from that? The second question is, every time the world thinks that we're running out of oil or gas, a new technology comes along and changes the whole situation. We had 3D mapping, then horizontal drilling, then software visualization, and now most recently fracking. So one would think that the consumption of oil and gas will be limited by the regulation of CO2 emissions way faster than it would by the growth of renewable energy. Do you think this is a situation, or is it going to be different in the future? Thanks.
Let me try to answer the second question first, because I don't remember the first question. In OECD countries and developed countries, oil consumption has peaked already. It's peaked because basically of slowing economic growth, slow population growth, and of more efficient automobiles, and that's certainly true in the U.S. The developed and high oil and high prices. It's who would have thought it would be $100 a barrel for oil for so long? I think that's kind of a shock. In the developing countries, there still is a demand. Anticipated rapidly growing demand for petroleum, primarily in transportation, and countries like China and India and Brazil and others, as their incomes grow, people are going to want to have cars and they're going to want to drive. And I don't think that the world's demand for petroleum is going to decline anytime soon. And how fast it grows depends on economic growth and what kinds of energy efficiency automobile mileage standards are put on, and what the price is. And I forgot the first question. Do you remember the first question?
It was about geopolitical relations with the Middle East and
yes.
OPEC's influence.
Okay, so one of it doesn't really. I think this is positive, not so much because the U.S. is going to in and of itself is going to import less oil. Where we import oil from doesn't really matter. It's a world market. If there's a disruption in the Middle East, it affects prices all over the world. But I think the fact that this technology can be deployed elsewhere will diversify supplies, increase supplies, and make disruptions less likely. And the world as a whole will be less dependent on politically unstable parts of the world where where political disruptions are more likely, and that's a good thing. Remember, even if we were oil and gas exporters, as the Canadians are, if there's an oil price shock, prices go up here. If you're living in New York City or Boston, your gasoline prices are going to go up. The primary difference is that the income redistribution is not from the U.S. To some thieves in Angola or to people in the Persian Gulf. It's from consumers to producers in the U.S. It's not a tax on the U.S. It's a redistribution of income in the U.S. It would still be politically controversial, I suspect, as to what to do about it, but the wealth impacts would be quite different. And the diversity in supplies and the lower share of production from politically sensitive and potentially disrupted areas will be much less significant. And as a result, the likelihood they would lead to a big shock would be much lower.
I think we have time for one more question.
Hi.
Okay.
Hi, it's Tony Yun. Question. So shale gas could be transformative, right? But what about based on your sort of role at Alfred P. Sloan Foundation and looking at other sort of disruptive technologies, what could be the next promising, realistic technologies, fuel cells or energy storage, anything that could be transformative to the scale of shale gas or something like that? Thanks.
Well, I don't want to list the technology because one of the nice things about disruptive technologies, you can't predict them. Let me say this. If someone could develop cheap grid-based storage for electricity, that would be a really big deal because that would make wind especially and to a somewhat lesser extent solar much more economical and viable than they are now. I mean, one of the problems with wind is you don't know when the wind's going to blow. It often blows at night, not during the day. We don't need more electricity at night. We need it during the day and so on. So I think storage is a potentially big deal. I think breakthroughs in fuel cell technology that can be both for storage and production would be potentially transformative. Battery technology, if you can get cheap batteries that will overcome the range aversion that people have to electric vehicles, that could be a really speed up the introduction of electric cars. So, I think there are a number of things people are working on in the storage area, the battery area, or other types of storage technologies. Batteries have been tough to make big advances, we keep putting money in it, and maybe we'll be successful. Of course, ultimately, if we can find some way of getting pure hydrogen, and unfortunately, it's attached. The H2 is attached to the O. If we could cheaply get pure hydrogen and burn it and turn it back into H2O, that would be a plus in many, many dimensions. But the first energy conference I ever went to in 1972 in Germany was someone said that the future was in hydrogen. I'm still waiting, so it's a long time.
Just to conclude, I would like to myself to ask you two questions. First question, if we look to world estimate reserves of non-conventional gas and oil, the U.S. is not number one, not even number two. However, when we see projections, in International Energy Agency, Department of Energy, they project that in 25 years, the U.S. will continue to be the number one producer of non-conventional oil and gas. For us, as an economist, this is absurd. What may be not allowing the two countries that have the largest reserves of non-conventional oil and gas, China and Argentina, for example, we understand what is not allowing them now to produce, but in 20 years, as an economist, for me, it's difficult. What do you think of this? Number one. Number two, around this technological oil and gas, there's a story about industrial renaissance of the U.S. which honestly, in my view, does not make excessive sense. What is your view about that?
Okay, I'll take the second one. You know, I think the Industrial Renaissance story has been, you know, overplayed. This will could be beneficial to some industries and the petrochemicals, fertilizers, maybe the few remaining industries cement. But we're not going to bring steel production of the type we used to have back to the U.S., and it's not going to have a big effect on automobile assembly and things like that. I think most of the benefits of lower prices, you know, consumers consume a lot of natural gas. That's the primary heating source. And we use a lot of natural gas in industries that are here and in the commercial sector, and that'll keep their costs lower. So I think it's all beneficial to the economy, but I don't think it's going to lead to a dramatic reversal in the decades-long trend of the decline of manufacturing employment in the U.S. It'll have very positive effects in some segments, and it'll have economic benefits in all the segments that use oil and natural gas. So, you know, I think it's positive, but I think some people get carried away with exactly how transformative it is. Now, in terms of the rest of the world, you know, I used to, when I was younger, build energy models, and you run your energy model unconstrained, and you get these results, and you look at them, and they say, "Ah, it can't possibly be." So you end up putting chewing gum here and there to keep it from doing what it wants to do, so it does what you want it to do. And I think here the major assumption you have to make, there are two assumptions about the shale reserves in Latin America and in China and Russia. One is we don't know much about the reserves, you know, how rich they are, what kinds of, there are reserves that in Poland, ExxonMobil went in there, they couldn't produce it. And we have to find out more about the reserves. And there are what I'll call industrial political economy issues in these countries. Would you want to invest in Argentina at the present time if you were former oil company, after they're still arguing about the last set of companies they expropriated? Probably not, and the local producers probably don't have the technological capabilities. But that could be a big surprise. It could be that this looks like a bonanza, and they invite companies with expertise from other countries in. They provide some way of securing their investments. But I think that's the assumption that's buried in a lot of these models. It's just a lot of uncertainty. You know, one way, if you were going to run one of these models, would be to actually look at the unconstrained case, given what we know about the reserves, I guess. And I think you'd find you get a lot of production in these other areas. So I'm optimistic.
Great. Perfect. Landing at 7:30, so we are ending on time. So as always, I learned an enormous amount listening to Paul. I'm grateful to you for being here. Thanks to Professor Manuel Pinho for organizing the Energy in Leaders Seminar series through the Center on Global Energy Policy. Nobody prefers to spend Halloween more than listening to discussion of what we were just talking about, the energy transformation in China and where that's headed, which I think is the next event in your series with Stephen Roach at Yale, former chief economist and head of Morgan Stanley Asia, on Thursday night. And then next week, Nobuo Tanaka, the former head of the International Energy Agency, who's a distinguished fellow at the Center on Global Energy Policy, who is based in Tokyo but will visit Colombia in the fall and in the spring. Next week, he will be in residence here at Colombia. And we'll be doing an event on Wednesday on the shale revolution, an event on Thursday on China energy and sustainability, and an event on Friday on the future of nuclear, which is the subject of his research for the year that he's with us as a fellow. So hope some of you will join some or all of those. And thanks for being here tonight. Thanks, everyone.